anyone who Frankenstein was, and you can count on some sort of an answer, but not always the right answer. For many people have transferred the name from mad scientists who created literature's most famous monster to the monster itself. Yet the theme, the name, represents that of the extraordinarily gifted man, the scientist who creates a being that destroys him in the end. And Frankenstein and his monster have become superstars of contemporary mythology. Throughout this program, you'll hear commentary on the myth and its writer, Mary Shelley. Hi, I'm Andrea Brown, and I'd like to take you behind the scenes of the St. John Theatre Company's production of Frankenstein, under the direction of Stephen Tobias. To give us a more intimate look into the production, who better to describe it but the director himself, Stephen Tobias.
Well, as you've been able to see by walking around the room tonight, we've got a lot of people involved here. A great deal of people are not with us. None of the cast is here tonight. They're out doing other things to help promote the play and learning lines and all that good stuff. All in all, we have on our end from the theater company about 40 people involved. We have, of course, as a partner in this venture, the Juvenile Diabetes Foundation, and there are 15, 20 people working on their end out helping us in administrating ticket sales and whatnot. So there is just a tremendous amount of people helping to put this project together, which is what it requires. We've had a great deal of promotion to date, thanks to our sponsors. We've had a number of quarter-page ads in the paper, courtesy of our contributing sponsors. Shoppers Drug Mart put a whole page ad in the paper last Saturday. CHSJ is just saturating the market with radio ads. We have a number of special things happening. We've had booths at Rhoda's Flea Market. We have a thing going on tonight at the Exhibition Park Raceway. Apparently they're having a Frankenstein pace, which will be the feature race of the evening, and we have actors out there who will be giving prizes and addressing the audience, and hopefully that will introduce us to a whole new audience right there. So we're really exploring every promotional means that we can to make this thing a great success, and I'm sure it will be.
As Stephen Tobias knows, there are many key elements that go into a successful production. Some of the key elements are special effects, sound and lighting, makeup, ticket sales, accounting, wardrobe, set design, and construction. To create the proper mood for the audience, the play must provide a visual setting for the time and location of the play. Mary Shelley is thought to have first took note of the castle and the Frankenstein name it bared while on a cruise down the Rhine in 1814. Another key element is in the gathering together of costumes that depict the age of the heir. I think you'll agree with me when I say Janet Foster and Carolyn Hayes have done an extraordinary job. Here they are to tell you about and show you the selection they have chosen.
Hello everyone, I'm Janet Foster and this is Carolyn Hayes, and we're the costume mistresses for the St. John Theatre Company, and together we've been trying to find costumes for Frankenstein. As you can see behind us, we have an array of costumes from the late 1800s, early 1900s, and Carolyn, let's show them this one here. We found this at Val Evans' shop, and this is going to be worn on the night by Elizabeth. And you can see it's a beautiful blue dress, and this is early 1900s. Next to that one, there's a real neat costume that we found at Vince Mudge's. This is you can see the helmet. Where did he say he? We have to look after this really well, don't we?
It's a Prussian First World War.
Prussian, yeah. And here's the outfit that goes with us. Carolyn, you can tell them what this is.
Sam Brown.
That's right. That's a Sam Brown. And this is the uniform that Herr Mueller will wear in the show. And Anthony, can you come over here a sec? Because we're trying to get these shirts to look Victorian. And if you can turn around there, what we've done is taken a modern shirt, turn the collar over, and we're going to put this bow around it like this. Wait, sorry, I nearly fast you one there. Going to try and get Anthony to look as Victorian as we can here. And now we have a jacket somewhere. If you could put this on, we'll get some idea of what it should look like. There, turn around. He looks pretty stiff-necked, doesn't he? I think you will do in that. That's just a modern shirt with the collar turned over a little tiny bit there. Thank you, dear. we also had quite a fabulous hat. What do we do with the hats there? Oh, up here. This one is going to be worn by Frau Mueller. And you can see that's quite a neat hat. Here, Carolyn, you can put that one on. And this little black bonnet. These are late 18th century. And they also came from Val Evans. Cute. And what else do we have here? Oh, there you are. This is a pretty blouse. It's going to be worn during one of the scenes. And a purple skirt. Here we go.
This goes
with this.
With the hat.
Oh, with the hat. Stick the hat on my head then. There. How about that? So we're still in the middle of trying to get this wardrobe sorted out. And we'll be completely organized by next week, trust us. But there you go. It's going to look really great. I think that's... Oh, another thing from Vince Mudge, just to add that final touch for the lady that's going out in the evening, we have a short, late 18th century cape. And we have been looking for this stuff since... How long has it taken us, Carolyn? Taken us...
No.
We've been searching for 6 weeks for all these costumes, and we're almost there. We're down to small things like shoes and things like that, and I think we're virtually ready for the night, aren't we?
Just about.
We got a lot of the things in our shirts and things we got from Frenchies and the Salvation Army, and a lot of the clothes that we're ripping apart came from Frenchies and the Salvation Army. So, budget's pretty good, really.
Undeniably, the most important of the key elements are the actors. Beginning at the first reading, the actors are developing their character and creating their interaction with the other characters in the story.
Victor, I know the shock is great, but to blame yourself for such an act...
It's true, Henry. It is true. I am responsible.
I wish that I could simply offer my condolences. But I regret that I am here in my official capacity. Since your father has taken to his bed, I've asked Elizabeth to join us here.
Elizabeth! She must not be involved in this. She must not know what has occurred.
She already knows.
No! She... Victor! Calm yourself, please.
No! No, it's impossible. You cannot think that she would ever have harmed William. She
cared not to suit me, for then I will be rid of both you and your despicable companion.
I'll hear no more of this.
Do you threaten me again?
It grows tiresome.
We have made a bargain. I will honor it.
The creature grabs him and hurls him to the floor, rushes down, arm raised, looms over him beside himself with rage. He stops.
No. Shall you find release in death while I remain desolate and alive? You have destroyed my dreams and hopes of peace.
Well, Lyman told me he was there for a while, but then it seems he disappeared.
Disappeared?
Yes. They say that he was acting rather strangely.
You're right, Father. The future is the only thing that matters now.
Come, the two of you. The guests are waiting. It is time. Come along now. Plenty of time for that.
Victor, I'm nearly gone. Then why are you...
You should be the instrument of my revenge. Your scream shall summon him here, and he shall see I have kept my word. Oh, I wish I did not have to harm you.
I just want to say that as you can see, there's a lot to do. And although we do have a lot of rehearsal time booked, we're going to have to use it well. So I just want to ask everyone...
Under the close scrutiny of their director, the actors not only memorize lines, but become the characters. Let's take them away from their busy rehearsal time and let them introduce themselves.
and trying to...
Hi, my name is David Cook. I'm offstage a freelance writer, and I play Hans Metz in this show, who is a combination murderer, grave robber. And I got involved with community theater because I just truly love it.
Hello, I'm Noel Horgan. I'm a retired school teacher. I've been involved with amateur drama ever since I was in high school. It's been great fun all my life. In this play, I am a blind hermit and I die. Sounds like fun.
Hi, I'm Eric Jackson, and I play Alphonse, Frankenstein's father, and I'm afraid I die as well. This is going to be a great play with an awful lot of action and an awful lot of dying. The company is doing a great job with this play, and we hope to have really big audiences.
Hi, my name is Peter Oxley. I just came in off the street and got thrown into the play. I play Schmidt, and I'm sort of the sidekick of the real bad guy. And in my spare time, I like to, what do I like to do? I like to do a little bit of painting, a little bit of acting, like game shows. I like to do crossword puzzles. I was actually born in a Kmart parking lot in Tallahassee, Florida, in the back of a VW Combi van. Thank you. Enjoy the show.
My name is Teresa Patterson. I play Elizabeth. I don't even know my last name.
It doesn't matter.
Lavenza, thank you. It is not.
It's Elizabeth Smith.
Elizabeth Smith. And I'm Frankenstein's fiance. I don't quite get to marry him because I get killed.
Do you do it?
No, this is a very old-fashioned sort of thing. We're engaged and we don't.
Wait a minute. We don't do it?
No, stop! That's it.
We're the Muellers, and we don't die. And there's a good reason for that, because we're better than everybody else. In real life, I'm Mary Stewart. I'm a teacher at KV. Just like to remind all my students to make sure their homework is done. Just kidding. This is my first play with the St. John Theatre Company, and I'm too excited.
My name's Robert McClarty. I play Herr Mueller, the jovial local magistrate and part-time hangman, and I take a great professional interest in my work.
Oh, honey.
Am I on? Hello, my name is Brian Dobbelstein. I play Henry Clairvel in this play. I am a full-time student, and I don't do much of anything else besides study and read plays and write poetry and do art, and I'm very, very talented, actually. And I'd just like to thank all those who nominated me for this award, and if the members of the Academy are here, please vote for me. And I'll just pass this mic on before I make a complete fool of myself.
Hello. I'm alive. My name's Jeff Bergeron, and I play the creature in Frankenstein. It's being put on by the company, and they wanted us all to sit up here and say a little bit into the camera. So here it was.
Hi, my name's Andrew Mazzetti, and I play Dr. Who? Frankenstein. Dr. Frankenstein in this play called Frankenstein. I die, but I deserve to die because I'm not a very nice person.
Well,
no, really.
He's right. He's part of his riches.
But it's a very good play, I think, or it will be. I still haven't figured out how Jeff's gonna pick me up, break my back, but I'm sure that we'll come up with something before we have to go on stage and do it. Jeff, I think we should practice that maneuver.
Can I?
Sure.
Right now, on camera. What?
Okay, the flying tackle. No, thank you very much. Please buy tickets.
To carry out their theatrics, a set in tune with the time must be designed. Let's have Stephen explain the intricate design of the set.
In what Peter Salmon has come up with here is a set
which is meant to be very versatile because we have to have very fast set changes. If you look up here, what we're looking at really are two large architectural units which will be in place during the entire play and very plain on the front so that we can project things on them, set things in front of them, and they can really serve as a background for almost any set. If you look at this in particular, this is the opening graveyard scene, and what will happen is you'll have this archway and these doors which will just sit right onto pins which will be permanent fixtures on these architectural units, so that in about 30 seconds someone can come in and hang these doors and someone can come in and hang this sign. And then this unit here, which would be actually on a wooden platform on wheels, will actually roll into place, and there you'll have it right there. And this will actually form the actual grave unit that the body is taken out of, which eventually becomes the creature. So there's a set change that, you know, we believe the set for that scene will be quite effective, and it will really only take about 15 seconds to put that set into place with four or five people changing the set. Okay, now we have here the same two architectural units still in place, but if you remember the first ones that we looked at, the covering was plain and there were no openings in it. Well, what there actually will be on these is a large hinged door, the same size as this, that will actually open right up so that this space would essentially be filled with another wall unit. When these open up, they will expose another wall immediately behind with the door and window in place. So with this wall solidly built through the center, that becomes the basis of the laboratory scene. And then we have a number of units, a bed unit, electrical units, switching units, lab units, desk units, which will roll into place. So again, we're looking at another unit which, although the end result will be something quite complicated, to actually move it into place is a process that might take about 30 seconds. This shutter gets opened, that shutter gets opened, somebody else moves a stair into place, and we have three or four units on wheels that actually roll into place and plug in to create the electrical effects. Very, very simple and straightforward, but something we think will be very effective on the stage. So if you look at the two together, now there it is with the, there's the unit with the coverings on it and the cemetery wrought iron gates in place. Now there's the same unit in place with the doors open, and you can actually see the door and window units in behind that. This same unit will be used throughout the entire play so that perhaps for one scene, on the same pins that we have pinned the cemetery arch, perhaps it's a French door unit, and it becomes an interior set so that you have a French door right here and brick walls on either side. For another scene, that could become the basis of an exterior hut, like a thatched hut kind of affair, where De Lacy, the blind beggar, stays, who actually teaches the creature to read and whatnot. And again, these units being plain when they're covered, we can do things like project forest scenes onto it. We can project nighttime images, clouds, whatever we want to do, and they become really like a huge projection screen.
The lines have been rehearsed, the set has been constructed, the wardrobe has been prepared. Finally, we must create the creature. The transformation is a long and tedious process. Under the skillful hands of makeup artist Scott Hamilton, Jeff's features will be transformed into the hideous monster. Phase one consists of Jeff being covered with a slimy concoction that is embedded into every pore of his facial feature. After this mixture has been allowed to gel into a rubber-like substance, the mold is carefully cut away. Now plaster of Paris is poured into the mold, ensuring that there are no air bubbles in it. After the plaster of Paris has hardened, the rubber mold is peeled away, revealing an exact replica of the actor's features. From the bust, the makeup artist will construct the actual mass that the actor will manifest during the performance. It is interesting to note that when Frankenstein was first filmed in 1910, the creature featured was a wild and ragged monster that looked more like a tramp than the classic scarred and bolted eyesore of later productions. The story of the creature is almost as fascinating and bizarre a saga as that of the creation of the monster itself. Frankenstein came to be through the eyes of its author, Mary Shelley. Shelley, between the ages of 16 and 25, lived what she called herself an incarnate romance. Her graphic and vivid tale has shocked its readers since its birth almost 100 years ago. Early filmmakers realized that it was a perfect theme for cinema audiences in search of new thrills. Frankenstein is a tale of darkness. Speaking of darkness, the curtains are about to go up on the production of Frankenstein. Watch with me the last-minute preparations and the hustle and bustle going on backstage.
Hello, Mom.
This is kind of like truth or dare behind the scenes. Did you hear that?
Jays tonight, 5 games.
Stage is set, the effects have been primed. The nervous director must now put his trust in that all possible measures have been taken to ensure the performance is an astounding success. Been watching the behind-the-scenes of Frankenstein, directed by Stephen Tobias and performed by the St. John Theatre Company. And I've been your host, Andrea Brown, taking you through Mary Shelley's Waking Dream.